Well, thank you so much. Thanks for having me, and it's really my pleasure to be here today. Even more so, this is Uppsala, my own old university. And every now and then, I come back to university and to the student club, which I belong to, and I go back to my wife and I say, it's fantastic. You know, it's almost, it looks like, and it feels like, just simply like yesterday. And my wife smiles and says, well, it does, but you don't. So. Nevertheless, I would like to contribute with three very brief reflections on today's theme of aging in its very broad sense. And the first is actually, before aging comes newborns. So we take it in the right order. Before aging comes the newborns, and I think we have to start here to be able to understand what's really happening later on. Because here we see a kind of a precondition for demography later on. We have a few countries in Europe, I guess there are more than, but Sweden and France are normally mentioned as countries almost replacing itself in terms of fertility. And as you know, just decades ago, and I guess as Hans Rosling will tell you much more professionally than I could do later on this afternoon, just a few decades ago, the world was full of countries who had too high rates of fertility. The main problem was the number of babies being born, and sometimes the number of babies also being surviving. Today, at least in Europe, we have a lot of countries situation is the most dramatic one. If you go to Germany, they will lose some 15 million people for the coming 4 or 5 decades. They have a shrinking workforce if it was not for emigrating people from other European countries. That has a dramatic impact on German industry, just to take one example. Just a few months ago, I had the privilege of going to Latvia and to South Korea. And they are very different, obviously, from in many respects, but they have some very obvious common denominators as well. One of them is, actually, they have very few newborns being born, actually. The latest figures for South Korea is actually even lower. Someone told me 1.19. 1.19, which is all-time low, I would say. And if you take a few similarities between South Korea and Latvia, that is a dramatic raise in longevity since quite long, very low levels of infant mortality. They're very reluctant to immigration, both countries. If you add to that the Latvian recent story of massive emigration, then you have a dramatic situation, a really dramatic situation. And my basic point I would like to make here is actually a sound society really has to make efforts to make people actually wanting to have babies. And to be able to do that, you actually have to have social policies and basically social policies and individual preference, of course, for making it possible to combine family life on the one hand and professional life on the other hand. If you do not do that, you will end up in severe problems, regardless of what you do later on in this aging society. I simply want to stress this because what we do here is of extreme importance to what we could be able to do later on. My second comment would be in the very core of demography. And this is how we normally look at it, the demographic challenge. And we are all supposed to look a bit nervous. This is a polite way of saying that we are all turning older and older, okay? And the graph tries to explain that the ratio between normally working age people in contrast to old people is changing. More old people relying on fewer working age people. That's basically it. And of course, this is a true picture. This is true also in Sweden, where we have this reasonable good fertility foundation for demography. So this is true, but still, it hides more than it explains. It doesn't really say anything about what happened and when did it happen. So I asked experts in my ministry, that's one of the privileges you have as a minister, you can ask professional people to do things for you. That's a very underestimated asset. And I asked them, have a closer look, make it a historic look, and make it much more in detail. So they came back with a few slides, and they tried to answer the question, the very interesting question, when do we really die? When do we really die? That's a question we should ask ourselves more often. And they came back with the slide starting at 1751. And the answer to that question was extremely simple at the time. We died immediately. Infant mortality rates were extremely high. Someone told me every third pregnancy and birth resulted in a baby or mother not surviving what happened. So this is where we started in 1751. And then we can follow every period of war Sweden was involved in, or diseases, or epidemics, or starvation periods, until 1900. And then things are changing. Child mortality, infant mortality is really decreasing, and the pyramid is rapidly turning to the right. And we live longer than ever before. This slide is actually saying something quite dramatic. It tries to say that for the first time ever in Sweden, many more people actually disease after turning 100 than diseasing as infants. This is a dramatic change of the demographic preconditions for a society. And this is actually has name. I mean, a lot of names are obvious. You can see antibiotics, obviously. Educational preconditions for a lot of people, obviously. Medical preconditions, everybody having the chance to see a doctor and to have advanced medical care. The medical industry, obviously. Lifestyle changes for the last decades, obviously. So there are many, many things behind these that makes this graph very self-evident. So what I'm trying to say is not that there's something strange. This is actually to sum all the successes we've had for the last 100 years in Swedish and a lot of Western European welfare states policies. That's just good. That's just great. But it's not a great thing to call it the demographic challenge, because the opposite would be the challenge. This is not the challenge. What is being challenged, basically, is simply something else. It is the Swedish, because now I'm talking for Swedish conditions, the Swedish tradition of entering the workforce at age of 27, making an exit at the age of 63.5. That is being challenged in a massive way. Because if we insist to have that short working life, then we also will have to insist to either be poor when we grow old, or set off 50% of our income during these very few years of working age to be able to survive as pensioners for the coming 40 years. That is actually the main message. My final comment would be that if this suggests that raising retirement ages are absolutely necessary, slowly but firmly, is absolutely necessary if we want to avoid a very, very problematic situation. And you know, that situation is very present in different places. Let's return to South Korea. Working people in South Korea are pretty well off. Very few people, working people in South Korea, suffer from poverty. Very many old people in South Korea do suffer from poverty. In the lack of a sustainable retirement scheme, in the midst of a changing society where young people do not anymore feel the obligation or having the preconditions for taking care of old people the old style way. Ends up in very many old people having worked previously, now are not working, but end up in poverty. So we really have to think this through. So if this slide just tries to say that we really have to start the process of raising retirement ages, the next slide will say something else. It is also possible. Those of you who are familiar to research in economics or research in social work are also probably very familiar to the concept of the Gini coefficient. The Gini coefficient is a very easy way to try to describe the income distribution in a country. It basically goes from 0 to 1. In the case of 0, everybody in the country have exactly the same income. It's an extremely equal society. Everybody has the same income. If the situation is 1, one person has all the income and the rest has nothing. Okay? That's basically it. And all countries can be described in terms of Gini coefficient. Sweden is normally labeled 0.26, 0.27. The European Union as an average as some kind 0.3, 0.31. The UK, US, 0.33, 0.35. According to the newspaper, The Economist, China, they stopped measuring when they exceeded 0.5. Okay? So just having a clue. In this slide, we try to utilize the concept of the Gini coefficient, but for lifespan or for life expectancy, describing how equal or how unequal are we in terms of life expectancy. In Sweden, this is. And as you can see, we had extremely high levels of the Gini coefficient in the 700s, 1800s, 0.5, 0.6, and a slow decrease and a rapid decrease from 1850, 1860, 1870s, and still ongoing. Still ongoing decrease in terms of inequality. Sweden is slowly becoming more and more equal also in terms of life expectancy. And this is really of importance because that tries to say that it's also possible to slowly increase retirement ages. Because otherwise, the normal inequality is connected to the fact that normally people who are well off, they have high education, they earn a lot of money, they also live longer. And people with low income, low education, they live less. They have a shorter lifespan. That means a redistribution from those well off with good income, high education, to those from those less well off. What this tries to say is that is less and less an issue because more people can foresee a long life and long possible working life. And actually, comparing Sweden with other countries, Sweden has, as far as we could find out, the lowest measured levels of Gini coefficient in terms of life expectancy in the world right now. And that is a good starting point for a difficult project. Finally, I would say age is a matter of perception. Age is a matter of perception. Which is good news for a person like me who turned 50 a few months ago. Because either you have two options. Either you feel that the end is 63.5. If the end is 63.5, you start the end at around 60. You stop changing workplace or changing occupation at 55. And you start belonging to the older workforce at 50. Okay? That's one option. The other option is from AARP, the extremely big American retired people's organization, kind of. It's like Swedish PRO, kind of. Okay? So with the one hand, they are really like PRO, that's the main Swedish retired people's organization. And they fight for better pensions, and they fight against worse conditions for old people. That's the traditional role. With the other hand, they do something else. They fight for reinvent yourself. Do something more. After being working for 30 years in the same occupation, do what you never did before. Do something else. Do what you actually have potential for, but haven't realized yet. And they show that with a lot of old people, as you see. Brad Pitt, for example. And that is really changing how we look upon experienced people's experiences. And I really think this is a good example for Sweden as well, because as a researcher from Uppsala actually told me a few months ago, when we talk about age discrimination, in Swedish, that is not really a judicial thing. That is a matter of low expectations being shown towards people with experience. Low expectations to be able to learn new things, low expectations in terms of being adaptable, low expectations in terms of curiosity, and all that things. So she told me, age discrimination in the US may end up in court. And of course, they could end up in court in Sweden as well. But she said, age discrimination in Sweden, 2014, is what happens in the workplace when the young people at office and the older people at the office, they agree on the fact that those who have turned 60, they do not have to learn the new Microsoft Office package. That is what happens. If we fight that attitude, we will have extremely good fortune and we will have extremely good days to look ahead for. Thank you very much.
So you seem utterly optimistic, one would say, in that this is extremely plastic. It's our prejudices that we can easily alter.
Basically, yes. Basically, yes. I mean, obviously, there are restrictions, of course. Don't start your career as a ballet dancer at 65. I mean, obviously, but most things are much better than we normally expect them to be.
So how much is this in the hands of the politicians to set up the framework so this is possible?
Well, I mean, limited, but not very limited. I think you have to, as a politician, you have the responsibility to try to change those regulations and those restrictions that are actually possible to change through democratic ways. But you also have to talk about it, because there are many things that has to be changed in a personal way or at the workplace. One survey tried to explain that these low expectations, they come from employers, from unions, from colleagues at work. You know, so we tend, and perhaps they are also kind of, we mix them with a feeling that if I slow down, I will make it possible for someone younger than me to, you know, this kind of altruistic idea that. And basically, I think we have to realize that the more people contribute to the economy, to society, the more room there will be for other people to contribute as well. So there is not a zero-sum game.
Also, the stand-up comedians, they love to mock older people. We have Nils Petter Sundgren, an old filmmaker. I don't know how many times they scorn him for being old. So but it's also in our own attitudes, of course, how we talk at the kitchen table. Richard, what is your... Yeah, I saw you were scribbling down excitedly when you heard Ulf.
Thank you very much. Very interesting set of comments. You said something at the very beginning, which I think framed, perhaps, the discussion, when you spoke about the importance of civil society, and you mentioned that civil society was not really a part of the initial responses of people in terms of where they expected change to come from. Civil society in the sense of the community, the family, in some other countries, we would say church groups. I'm not sure whether I can say that here. How, this may sound almost contradictory, but how can the state further develop civil society? How does the state take power away from the state and give power, authority, responsibility to civil society? How do you do that? And of course, you only have 2 minutes to answer.
No, but just want to make sure I understand what do you mean, how to remove power from the state and to give it to the civil society, or?
Well, in the beginning you said that it was important to build a civil society.
Well,
how do you do that?
I was just trying to say that Sweden is Sweden in the same way as other countries have their own story. And in Sweden, we tend to look very much on the individual responsibility and the individual's rights and on the state's, the national state's obligations. We tend normally to prioritize those two entities compared to countries much more dedicated to civil society responsibilities, family responsibilities. And I, as most Swedes do, we see a lot of advantages in our kind of attitudes and values. And we honestly have to see there are problems as well, of course. And every time we look at countries who have a much more vibrant civil society taking a lot of responsibility, we realize that that might be something we quite often lack in Sweden. On the other hand, we normally trust that public common responsibilities, they are really there.
So that civil society, in fact, has been taken over by the state, and you are comfortable with that?
Well, taking over is...
I'm being controversial.
I think you have to go back a few hundred years, actually, to understand the very Swedish mix between individual responsibilities and political state responsibilities.
Well, focus him, but okay.
Well, yeah. Well, that's one good example, and we have a lot more of them. The church is one of those involved actors in this okay. story.
Thank you. Do we have any question or comment from the audience that you would like to share? Yes, please a microphone to our gentleman from Slovenia.
I'm Dr. Walsh from Slovenia, and my question to the minister as well as to Mr. Saltman is it correct to talk about silver society? Because we are underlying the level of aged people in the society, and by such a way we can support intergenerational tensions. Thank you.
You mean the risk of creating intergenerational tensions?
You showed us that the number of aged people is increasing very, very fast and in a very enormous way. And that the part of younger population is diminishing, which means that from some point of view, then play a different role within society than they did before. Which means that they need very important support. And if we talk only about silver societies, don't we neglect their needs?
In more normal kind of political circumstances, I normally stress the fact that there are very good reasons for a sustainable and sound retirement schemes, and a good reason for Sweden today to start the process of reforming the reformed pension scheme is actually to avoid a situation where we have this intergenerational conflict, or we create the foundation for a conflict. And we've been quite close to those situations in Sweden before. And now we try to stress the fact that every generation kind of bears its own future costs. What you receive is actually very much connected to what you have contributed with and how the economy develops. And as far as we can go, say that that's a way of avoiding a situation where old people actually clash with young people in a fight of whose interests are the most important ones. So I think that the retirement ages are extremely crucial to avoiding a situation where old people and young people start fighting.
Wonderful input, and thank you very much for your interesting view.